just start today's lesson. And in this unit, we're going to talk about procurement and outsourcing. And this is, of course, it's one of the important logistic activities, or one of the important logistics operations. Okay, let me remind you with this slide. First of all, I think maybe you still remember the meaning of logistics, the definitions that I gave to you in maybe two weeks ago. Okay, logistics involve getting in the right way the right product in the right quantity and quality, right quality, in the right place at the right time for the right customer at the right cost. Okay, and we call this 8 R's definition of the logistics. Okay, and also we mentioned that logistics operations have several category of activities, like the slide shows, like sourcing and purchasing. Okay, for a firm, especially the manufacturing firm, it needs to buy inputs, different kind of inputs from suppliers, right? So this is the sourcing and purchasing parts. This is in the very beginning, okay? So in the very beginning, the firm need to try to get proper materials, proper inputs, sometimes even get some service from some service providers. For example, some firms maybe need some transportation service, right? So sourcing and purchasing, okay, is the first part. And then managing inventory, maintaining our warehouses and arranging transportation and delivery. There are several kinds of activities here. And we will try to talk about these activities in the following weeks. Okay. Like this week, we're going to mention the first one, the sourcing and purchasing. Okay. And also last week, we mentioned there are three key flows within the supply chain. Flow of materials, flow of information, right? These are two flows that we can right away think about, right? And also we have other kind of flows. For example, some people or facility or equipment, etc. Of course, including financial flows or money flow. Okay. So these are just try to remind you. Okay, that's last week mentioned about logistics. Okay. And nowadays, we have been experiencing so-called globalization trend. It's a very prominent trend in recent 1 or 2 decades. Okay. That means gradually the enterprises, they just go global. In the beginning, they maybe have their headquarters, their production bases, etc., in their mother country. But later on, when they try to expand their market, they maybe in the beginning they do the international trade, and gradually they say they want to go to other countries to establish some factories or marketing firms or even research and development bases. Okay, so gradually when a firm tries to go global, try to establish different kind of facilities in different countries, then they need to very carefully consider about the outsourcing parts, especially the so-called global outsourcing. This activity are very important for both manufacturing firms or service sector, service firms. So this unit, in the beginning, we try to mention the basic concept of sourcing and purchasing. And then we will explain the outsourcing, the concept of outsourcing, how affirmed does its outsourcing? What factors should they consider it, especially when we can see many failures in the outsourcing? What are those major reasons for those failures? And this unit, we're going to talk about all these. So in this chapter, of course, in the beginning, I'll try to define the procurement, and also I'll mention the procurement process, the typical procurement process in the firm. And as I mentioned, we try to explain what factors that affect outsourcing. Okay. Outsourcing actually is also one kind of procurement, okay. Procurement process. But it's outsourcing basically try to transfer a complete process, say maybe a production process, to other firms. Okay. So it's a little bit different. But for procurement process, basically, as I mentioned, most of time means we buy materials, buy inputs, buy different components from suppliers. But outsourcing, we completely transfer a entire process to another firm. Okay, so they are a little bit different. Okay. So we try to explain, okay, why we should consider this strategy. Why should some companies make their outsourcing arrangements nowadays? Okay. And especially these outsourcing arrangements usually will involve several countries, right? Several nations. I mean, you will consider outsource the process to the firms not only in your home country, but also could be in another nation, in another country. And also here, we also try to identify some reasons why many outsourcing firms turn out to be not so successful. And then, of course, we come back to talk about how do we evaluate an outsourcee, or how do we select an outsourcee according to what kind of criteria. And among these criteria, okay, some may be very basic. That means each firm, in order to be considered a possible candidate, need to meet these criteria. And also, we have advanced criteria. That means in order for these a candidate to be selected as a real outsourcee, they need to satisfy some further criteria or some criteria with higher standard. Okay, so we also mentioned this. And the last part of this unit, we will talk about how the relationships between outsourcer and outsourcees involve. They involve through several stages. What are those stages? Okay. So this will be the topics in this unit. So first of all, let's look at sourcing, purchasing, and procurement. Okay, three terms. But actually, the last one can contain the meaning of the first two. Okay, sourcing and purchasing. So and from this introduction, then we will use the term procurement. Okay, so sourcing and purchasing, basically they are activities at different stages, but they are related to cost, right? Sourcing means you try to identify, try to find a possible supplier or some possible suppliers, right? You try to identify them, try to evaluate them, try to work with them, try to develop relationships with them. Okay, that's sourcing part. Okay, then once you select one a supplier, okay, from the list or from the candidates, then of course you need to do actual buying, right? You need to do actual buying. You need to specify your specifications, your requirements, your dates of requests, etc., right? And then communicate with the selected suppliers, right? And do the actual buying. Okay. And the supplier, once the supplier get your order, then they will arrange the delivery of the goods, of course, and then you have to arrange the payment to them. Okay. So sourcing and purchasing, one is in the first part, okay, in the beginning, you need to identify suitable suppliers, and the other, the purchasing is doing the actual buying. Right? But put them together, we can use this term to represent the meanings of both terms. We used procurement. So procurement includes sourcing and purchasing and cover all activities from identifying suppliers to delivery, identifying actual buying and delivery arrangements, etc. Okay, the entire process, procurement process. Okay. But of course, nowadays, there's one trend is some firms are even considered to outsource this entire procurement process to a professional company. Okay. So this is a trend, but still, of course, some companies, they do this part on their own. Okay. So this is procurement. So why procurement is so important? It's very simple idea that everyone should know that because we buy materials, buy inputs, buy some components in order to make our final products. If your components do not have a very suitable quality, then your final products, of course, will not be very, very good in terms of quality functions, etc. So the quality of the inputs will have very great influences on the final products and even on the consumer's satisfaction. Because when consumer get the products with not very satisfied quality, then they maybe next time they don't buy this the products from this company, right? So procurement is very important, right? Especially for those manufacturing companies, right? And also from this perspective, procurement accounts like more than 60% of the total cost. So we need to do it very carefully. If we can save money or reduce cost from here, then we can reduce our product cost, our cost of the final goods. Okay. And this is for the manufacturing firm, okay, this figure, 60%, okay. However, for the retailing firm, this figure will be even higher. It could be like higher than 90%. So that means when a retailer buy a product from maybe manufacturer at say $100, okay, then maybe its price for this maybe just 110 or 108, etc. You cannot add too high to the production cost. You cannot say the markup, say I want 20, 30 or whatever, okay. So usually for the retailing firm, maybe you add up maybe like 10% or 8% or 5%, right? Because the retailing market is very competitive, right? So it's very difficult for you to set up a higher price in order to get a higher revenue, okay. And procurement process also will influence the supply chain management. That means the procurement process, because you get the materials, components from suppliers, right? If the quality or the quality of the components do not conform to your specifications, right? Or the cost of this item, these components are higher than maybe the cost of the products buying from other suppliers, then this will increase your cost, increase your total cost. And also, if the suppliers cannot deliver the components or the ordered items on time, then this may cause your production line stop. That means you need to still pay the workers. You need to pay whatever electricity, etc. Just wait for the orders. Wait for the items to come to your factory. Right. So on-time delivery is also important. Right. So usually we try to evaluate suppliers to see whether or not they can reliably deliver every order on time. Of course, you can ask them like 100% on-time delivery. However, you can set a criteria, maybe 90%. Maybe every say 10 times, you ask at least 9 times on-time deliveries. And also, this procurement also related to the supplier management and supplier relationships. And later on, we will mention about how to manage the supplier, how to develop the relationship with suppliers if you are a manufacturing firm. Okay, now, we know the procurement process. Procurement includes sourcing and purchasing, actual buying, right? But here, we try to classify the entire process into 5 stages, actually. Okay, the 5 stages for the procurement process. So in the beginning, we need to do the so-called sourcing part, right? We need to find these possible suppliers, right? So in the beginning, we need to give out some information. We can have our specification, we can have the quality, the level of quality, and the quantity, how many units we need. And we also need to have this dates required information release, right? So in the beginning, we can use like a RFQ or RFT, RFI or RFP, request for quote, request for tender, request for information, request for proposal, whatever. These 4 documents, we can specify our requirements on these documents, and then we release these documents to some interested suppliers, right? Either through internet or some physical media. And then these suppliers who read this documents, right? Then some of them may be interested in doing business with you, and some of them, yeah, then they may be feel they have the ability to provide this service to you. So they write some kind of proposal, or they come to you, say, okay, we are qualified, we can provide this service, we can do this business with you. Okay, that's the first stage. Okay, so in the end of this stage, we may have a list of candidate suppliers, right? Of course, these suppliers already been evaluated according to some basic criteria. Okay. And just like the stage 2, okay, we can see that once they show their capability, their previous performance record, their offered price and their service promise and others, whether or not they can be very flexible or not. All this information they specify on their document, and they submit this document to you, right? And you have this very clear and standard information, okay? Every supplier submit this document have the same set of information, right? And you can evaluate these suppliers according to some criteria you specify, you have in mind. And as I mentioned, we can classify these criteria into 2 types. One is basic one, the basic set. We call this order qualifiers. That means These are the minimum level, minimum requirement that a supplier need to satisfy, need to meet this criteria, need meet this minimum requirement in order to be considered a possible candidate. Okay. And then we use another set of criteria, what we call the order winners. Order winners. These are another set criteria to evaluate those selected suppliers from the previous step. Okay. And then we evaluate them according to the order of winners, and then we can have the preference order for these possible suppliers. And maybe you will select the number one on the list, or top two or top three, depends on you use a sort of single sourcing or multiple sourcing. Usually firms use multiple sourcing in order to avoid some kind of risks. So this is the second stage, supplier selection. We use first set order qualifier, and then the second set, the order winner. Okay, both are criteria predetermined by the firm. Okay. And then the third stage, we already have this supplier and selected, and we do the actual buying with this supplier. We place an order to this supplier, right? And then stage four, we need to do order management. We not just place an order to the supplier, we also need to monitor the progress, right? We need to monitor the progress, we need to track, and sometimes maybe we need to modify the order because maybe our customers require more units, and we have to maybe say increase our quantity. We need to tell our supplier, okay, please, now we need the extra, maybe 500 units, right? So this is order management. Okay, that means we have to very carefully to monitor the entire process. And then the stage five, you just really get the items we ordered. We receive them. Of course, we still need to make sure that whether or not these items delivered are confirmed to our specifications or not. Maybe we can do some kind of sampling, okay? Take sample from items delivered, items received. And maybe we can set some criteria. For example, we take 10 units as a sample from this dispatch or this delivery, okay? And we find, say, two items are not so conformed to our specification. Then, according to our rule, maybe we say, okay, we just reject this batch. Please just take this batch back. I mean, we reject this entire delivery, okay? That could happen, right? Of course, nowadays, once we developed a very close relationship with our suppliers, okay, we can skip this part. That means we already check their production process. We already help them to establish quality control process. And then we believe that they can manufacture with very high quality outputs. That means we believe that their items come to our factory, their components come to our factory, will have very, very small possibility that this item cannot work, this component cannot work, okay, cannot be used as input to our production process. So usually in the practice, people say adopt a so-called Six Sigma. I don't know whether you know this Six Sigma or not. Six Sigma means for every 1 million parts produced, we only allow three or four parts to be not conform to the specification. Okay, so according to the normal curve, okay, we specify Six Sigma. That means within this Six Sigma, these items will be conform to the specification and can be used as the inputs to our production process. But beyond this Six Sigma, okay, this will not be usable. And we need to throw them away. But beyond this Six Sigma limit, what's the percentage? As just I mentioned, every 1 million has only 3 or 4 parts, 3 or 4 units. So this is a very strict standard. Okay. So once we implement this kind of practice, then basically we don't need to take sample from the delivery. We just let it go to our warehouse, just receive the entire batch.
This is like ideal principle, not like every company should introduce this.
Yes, but nowadays some company claim that they are so-called world-class manufacturer. They implement this kind of practice. Yes. So I just mentioned multiple sourcing or single sourcing, right? Single sourcing is easier to manage, right? Because you just deal with one supplier, single supplier, okay? It's very simple, right? However, a single supplier will have a risk, right? Once something happened to this supplier, say maybe their factory on fire, they cannot deliver the items that they promised, then if you don't have an alternative supply, then very likely you will suffer a lot. Okay, you cannot satisfy your customers' orders. Right? You cannot fulfill the orders from your customers, right? Because your suppliers cannot provide components. Okay? So multiple sourcing has one advantage, act as a backup, right? Once something happens, you can just go to other suppliers. And the other benefit is multiple sourcing brings in competition. These suppliers, they would always know other suppliers will replace them. Other suppliers will get more business from you. So they'll be very carefully do their parts, very carefully control their quality, very carefully monitor their delivery. Try to make sure they can, every time they can deliver on time. Okay. So that's another advantage. If you use so-called multiple sourcing, you can bring in the competition among these suppliers. Okay. So typically, a firm, okay, they will not just rely on one single supplier. Of course, they will not rely on huge amount of suppliers. That's also not very good practice. Okay. But they will usually, the better practice is try to maintain a few. Okay, a few depends, right? Maybe you can get about 3 or 5 or more. A few important suppliers, try to develop a very good relationship with these selected suppliers, right? And then you can make sure once something happened to some of them, then you still have other backup. Okay. And also, you can also have these firms to compete with each other. They will do their parts very seriously to deliver good quality items to you. Okay. And every time they try to deliver on time. Okay, we just know the procurement process, right? Procurement process and how firms maintain their policies. They will use a single or a multiple sourcing. Right? Now, we turn to outsourcing. And the other similar concept, offshoring, okay. They are different, okay. But sometimes people get confused with these two terms. Some people will consider these are the same. However, they are a little bit different, okay. And outsourcing or offshoring, of course, nowadays becomes more and more popular, right? But why? reasons just on this side, this slide. Because of the international trade, because of the growth in international trade in recent years, recent decades, maybe for this 2 or 3 decades. I think you can see that the growth, okay, in this international trade. And since maybe World War II, right, 1945, those countries like Japan, Germany, they revived since maybe after 1960s, and then had their industries. They produce different kind of products, and then sell these products to other nations, other countries. Right? In the beginning, maybe the United States, okay, they are the very few manufacturers in the world. Okay, so their firms can just go ahead produce or manufacture goods and sell the goods, sell the products, right, without any marketing activities, etc. Right, because at that time, at that years, whenever you produce products, there's always people to buy because supply is less than demand. But however, like Japan, like Germany, okay, and then later on in 1980, some Asian nations like Taiwan, Singapore, South Korea, Hong Kong, they also had the abilities, to produce those similar products at lower cost, right? So gradually the supplier no longer greater than the demand. Gradually maybe supply exceeds the demand, especially since maybe 1990s, right? At end of 1980s, we have mainland China and other countries to again join the production. So even the 21st century, we also can see some new countries to join the production, right? So you will see these different countries produce products for the all the other countries in this world. Okay, and they need to transfer or transport their goods to other countries. Okay, so in the beginning, maybe they do the export import, right? So that's our international trade. But later on, they do the global deployment. They just go ahead, go to the some countries to establish a production base to produce goods there, and then to serve markets nearby this region, nearby the countries near this region. Okay? But still, they need to have some kind of outsourcing, offshoring consideration. Now, outsourcing means to transfer entire process, okay, not just buy some materials, but transfer entire process, okay, to another firm, okay. For example, some manufacturers in United States, they transfer their production process to firms in Taiwan, okay. That is, we call them OEM companies, right? So these OEM companies in Taiwan produce goods for those firms, like in US, okay. Then in US, they I think most of them don't produce goods anymore. They do their maybe marketing parts. Okay? So the management of this entire process transferred to another company, and the firm just press an order. Quantity, the quality, the specification, date of required. And then this outsourcee just start manufacturing these goods and then deliver these goods according to the date required. This is outsourcing. So outsourcing means to handle the entire process ownership to that outsourcee, to the third party. to the outside sea. Okay. And offshoring, very similar. However, offshoring, of course, still transfer an entire process to another firm, but the company itself still have the control over this process. Like your firm, okay, transfer this production process to another firm, but your firm still has the power, has the control over this process. The outsourcing doesn't have this ownership. Okay. And this is a difference between outsourcing and offshoring. Okay. Usually offshoring is transfer the process to a lower cost country. Okay. But there we establish factory there. We hire their people because the workers there, the labor cost is lower. Okay. And you have some managers maybe sent from your headquarters, okay, and go there, you just hire the workers there. Okay. This is offshoring. But outsourcing, we just don't care about any this worker recruiting or other things. We just get the another firm to take care of everything. That's outsourcing, right? Offshoring is a little bit different, okay. But sometimes some firms, I say, outsourcing, still do offshoring. That means, for example, maybe a firm in Taiwan act as a outsourcing of a firm in the United States, but this firm can still transfer some of its processes to maybe another country, say Vietnam, and then this is offshoring, right? In order to keep their cost lower. But still, it's basically this firm is outsourcing, right? But outsourcing can do the offshoring. Okay. Of course, the original firm can also directly do the offshoring. Okay. So that's also possible practices that we can see in the business world. I think we all know that China and India now have become global centers for many companies. These companies could be manufacturing, software development, retailing, financial services, right? You see many banks go to China, go to India, right? And some retailing firms like Walmart, like Carrefour from different countries go to this region, China, India. Of course, we have friends in Taiwan too.
That doesn't change, I think it's the second topic. Doesn't change in a few years. I mean, 10 years ago, but yes, there are many companies from Europe or USA came in Asia for outsourcing or offshoring. But I mean, now the salaries in Asia
increase. Right.
This factor doesn't.
Yeah, gradually, I think some firms may think about. Transfer some, maybe there are some production bases to other nations like Vietnam, yeah. Still a low labor cost country. Yeah, but in mainland China, not good. Maybe you know the mainland China situation better than I.
Right? I don't know actually.
But nowadays, salary increase and the labor cost increase. Yeah, I think in mainland China, there are. University professors get paid higher than professors in Taiwan nowadays. But several years ago, maybe my income, okay, maybe it's several times of their income. But now, no. So, I think maybe it's still like before, say, 2008, 2007, okay. And yeah, we can assure that, the increased companies outsourcing their process or offshoring their process from Europe to Asia, right? But nowadays, maybe they go to still Asia, but some countries other than mainland China, right? Maybe they go to Vietnam or Cambodia, something like that. And also they can go to South America, some ferns like Brazil or Chile, other countries. And maybe later on in the future, maybe, I don't know, but my guess, okay, maybe ferns will go to Africa. That's also possible, but we don't know when. Once they, some infrastructures or some basic conditions get improved in that continent, then maybe firms will think about to their offshoring or to their outsourcing, right, there in that part of the world. And this number, okay, is was published in 2006 in an India magazine. It says 400 companies out of the Fortune 500 have research bases in China, and 125 bases in India. Okay, that's means these are very big companies like to do their outsourcing or offshoring in these two nations. And however, although there are more and more firms do their outsourcing, do their offshoring, right? But still, many firms failed. Many firms failed. We all know when a firm go to another country or go global, different countries, and if this firm doesn't do some adjustment according to the local culture or local custom or local regulations, then usually it has very high possibility to be not so successful in that country, unless it can make some adjustments once it encounter some frustrations there. Okay. So companies failed because they didn't adapt to the local factors. For example, infrastructure. Okay. This could be energy. Some countries are lack of certain energy. Some maybe has a very abundant energy, but the firm decided to go to that country, still need to consider energy will influence its firm in what ways. Okay. So energy could be a very important factor. Okay. Firms come to Taiwan, they usually they will ask for the high-tech firms. Okay. They maybe ask whether or not Taiwan can provide stable electricity, especially industrial electricity, okay, or water, okay, industrial water, okay, especially in a science park, maybe in Hsinchu. Okay. So energy is important. Other may also include like materials, transport and communication. In terms of materials, in Taiwan we still need to import many kind of materials from other countries, other nations. And however, in Taiwan, nowadays you can see the transport and communication is very good, established compared to maybe 20 years ago. Now we have many, many highway systems, right? Not just the highway number one. And nowadays we have highway number one, number three, north and south bound. Number five, okay, from Taipei to Yilan. And also we have many from east to west highway systems. And like in Taipei, we also Taipei City or New Taipei City, we have very convenient road systems, right? We can say nowadays, for example, we drive cars from here to Danshui. We can take a very quick way, find the south road in that part, that direction. Okay, and but maybe 15 years ago, maybe even earlier, if you want to go to Danshui from here, you have to just take like ordinary road, ordinary ways. Like from here, maybe Zhongshan north road, and then Beitou and then Danshui. But this will maybe take you more than 1 hour to get there. But nowadays, if you could go to the expressway, maybe 30 minutes or less than 30 minutes, you can get there. Okay. So in infrastructure, okay, energy, materials, transport, and communication. And also other factors like you have to consider about, think about the education system. Whether or not that country has good or well-educated employees, workers there, right? Like in Taiwan, I think you know that nowadays almost every high school graduate go to college in Taiwan, right? But previous time, especially in my time, my age, say when I was like 18 or 20 years old, every 10 high school graduates only has, say, about 2 get the opportunities to go to college, less than 20%. Nowadays, more than 95%, or even more than 100%. Okay, that's very different. But I think many countries nowadays, their education system so well maybe over developed. Okay, but the good thing is you have very good quality employees there. Okay. So if you could go there, and of course you hire these people, then they can do a very good job for your firms, for your factory. Okay. So education is important, and training, whether or not this country provides enough training facilities, training institutes, right? Either public or private. Like in Taiwan, we have some training centers, public one and also private ones. Okay. And also, we all need to consider the regulations, the laws, the local regulations, whether or not they have very well-established law systems can protect our firms there. So this is also important. And of course, culture is also important. Culture, okay? Organizational networks, especially culture. Okay? I think nowadays, many Western people like to come to maybe Taiwan or mainland China to learn the culture because they want to do business here. Of course, they need to get to know the Chinese people, how they think, how they act. So they have to first to get to know the culture. So I think you guys are very lucky and make very wise decisions to come here, right? Because you can learn the Chinese culture. Although maybe still there's some difference between mainland China and Taiwan, I mean, in terms of culture. But basically, they are very similar. Still, they are very similar. Why firms do the outsourcing? Because they can benefit from this decision. That's why they get motivated to implement such a strategy. Okay. So what are the reasons? Basically, we can think about the cost factor, right? The outsourcing can help a firm to reduce different kinds of costs. For example, reduce direct cost, direct labor cost, the direct material cost. Okay. Indirect cost, for example, if you hire well-educated people to manage your company, of course, this part will be the indirect cost. Indirect cost. If you hire a worker to do the assembly or in the production line, then these are direct labor costs. Indirect labor cost means those costs paid to the managers. Okay. And also we can reduce capital cost. Okay. Because when you outsource to another firm, then they need to consider hire those people, need to consider do the investment on those capital assets. They need to establish the factory, find a place to build the building to the factory, to buy the machines. Okay? So these capital costs can be avoided, can be reduced, right? Because you just transfer the process to them. Okay? And also we can reduce taxes. is different countries, they have different tax rates. Some countries, like Taiwan, for some industries, the government had some kind of tax reduction policy to encourage the investment in those industries. So maybe you just have opportunities to go to a country that the government encouraged that kind of industry to be developed in their country. So then they will give you this very good conditions, right? And also can reduce logistics, right? Because once you have firms near the market, then you don't need to spend a lot of money on the marine transportation or whatever transportation. So you can reduce logistics costs. You don't need to maintain your own warehouse, right? Because the outsourcer will take care of that part. Okay. So in this way, you can reduce logistics costs. And also, you can overcome tariff barriers. Okay. Some nations, they in order to protect their domestic industries, they will implement higher tariff, higher import taxes. And also, the outsourcing can help a firm to provide better customer service, right? Because you have a production base near the customers. Once they place an order, they can very quickly, in a very short time, get their orders, get their products, they get the products they ordered. Right? So that's increase their satisfaction. Right? So can provide better customer service. And of course, we do the outsourcing, we can spread the foreign exchange risks. And also, we can share risks with outsourcing, because they also invest on the capital cost, right? Although we don't do that part, right? We don't do the manufacturing there. We also have our risk in our part. So both sides can share the information, share the market information, share the maybe the production schedules, etc. In this way, they can manage their resources, for example, manage their inventory in a very reasonable way, reasonable level, right? So both sides don't need to prepare so much inventory, and they can save money, save cost, can share risk. And once something happens, for example, the economics not very good condition, right? And consumers don't purchase much, and then both sides need to reduce their scale. Maybe they lay off people, right? But this because both sides, okay, two companies do the same thing, okay, share different parts. Okay, one is maybe production, the other marketing. Then both sides suffer less from the bad, not good economic conditions. So we can share risk through this outsourcing arrangement. And we can also build alternative supply sources. Right? Some firms, although they do the outsourcing, they still have their own production in their home country. And because once the outsourcee has some kind of trouble, they still have the ability to satisfy the markets through their own production in their own country. Okay, so in this way, some firms, they don't completely stop their own production. But still, many companies really stop their production. Okay? So once they maintain their own production, then they can use their home production as an alternative. Once the outsourcee has some kind of trouble. Okay? And also, outsourcing arrangement can preempt potential competitors. Some potential competitors, maybe from your country or maybe from other countries, they may also interest in that market, maybe say the market in mainland China. But you just go there and you are the first one to go there. Okay, you get the resources, you get to know all the local people, local firms, and local government. You have very good relationship with them. And then other firms, okay, they see, okay, I want to do that also, but they will hesitate. They will think about whether or not they can do the same thing as you did, because you are already go there. You already established your relationship, your network in that country. Okay. So they maybe say, oh, no, I don't go to that place. Just try to go to maybe select other markets or other nations to do their deployment. Okay. That's possible. Okay. So in this way, we can try to preempt some potential competitors. Of course, some firms will still go there, even you already have bases there. Some competitors, maybe they are so powerful, they want to challenge you. Okay. So that's also possible. And of course, do the outsourcing can learn from local suppliers, local customers, or local competitors, right? Because you are not so familiar with the market, right? You go there, you speak different languages, you have different lifestyle, right? From those people in that market, right? You don't know their preference, you don't know what they like, they don't like. You have to go there and you get to know them. If you just do the international the export, you have no opportunities. You are never to really get to know these people, how they think, what they think. So through the outsourcing, you have this arrangement, close arrangement with these people. So you have the opportunity to learn from them. And the last one is, if we do outsourcing, we can get access to very good, talented people, okay, or very good capabilities from some countries, right? Like in Taiwan, okay, maybe we are very good at electronic engineering or computer engineering, and those firms need those are electronic firms or computer firms. They come here to establish their factories here. They can hire these people. They can hire these well-educated people. Right? We have very good university systems in Taiwan. Train these engineers here. Okay, so we have high-quality engineers. So that's why some companies like to come to Taiwan. During these several decades, you can see from northern part to southern part, you can see several factories in Hsinchu, Taichung, and maybe in Tainan, these cities. So these are the reasons why firms do outsourcing arrangements. Basically, these are the benefits that every firms try to see. Trends in the manufacturing sector emerging from globalization. Right? As I mentioned, globalization is a trend. Still is a trend. Okay, and more firms try to expand their markets, try to establish their marketing firms or their production firms in different countries. Because of this globalization trends, okay, nowadays we can see many firms try to pursue the global markets. They try to rely on this kind of growth strategy, okay, try to expand their market to other nations. And of course, because of globalization, firms encounter global competition. Okay, even if you don't go global, you don't go to other countries, still, you are very traditional, very local firm. You are just a pure domestic firm. Still, there are many firms in the same industry from other countries come to your nation, come to your country to compete with you. So, no matter you are a pure domestic firms, or you are a firms with a global deployment strategy, you encounter very severe competition nowadays, global competition. So these competitors come from different countries, and your partners could also come to different countries. You can cooperate with different firms in different countries. Okay? And your customers will also be in different countries. Okay? So this is a phenomenon. Nowadays, more and more people want to learn different languages, right? Because they encounter this global competition. They want to serve their international customers better. They want to cooperate with their international suppliers better. So they need to learn different culture, different languages. And also global sourcing. Nowadays, the firms, they identify suppliers not only from their local region, not only from their country, but also from suppliers in different countries. Okay. So global sourcing is a very popular. Okay, global sourcing, that's also a topic of this chapter. Okay. And global presence. Global presence means you have your brand to be seen in different parts in the world. Okay. Every firm try to make their products available in different countries. Try to let people in different countries know their brands. So even though maybe that market is not so strong or not so welcome this product, but still they try to show their face or try to be seen in that country. That's a global presence. Later on, they may have the opportunities to get welcomed by the local consumers. So they try to do the global presence as much as possible. And global value chain, okay, global value chain are resulting in complexity. Okay, that means the global value chain is very difficult to manage. But still, we need to manage this global supply chain or global value chain well. Otherwise, your global deployment strategy will not succeed. You need to still take care of this part. Okay, that means you need to rely on some tools or some talented people to manage this entire supply chain for you. Right? Say, for example, you can rely on IT technologies, network, internet, or computer systems, right, to coordinate our people in different countries, different nations. Right? We can have they discuss through the online conference. Right? We can do this. We can use that technology. So, although the global value chain creates some difficulties, still we need to overcome this difficulty. Okay? And also the global access. Okay? You can have the opportunity to get access to some expertise, some skills, or some technologies in different countries. Right? So for example, you can get very advanced optical technology in Japan. You can get electronic engineering expertise in Taiwan. Right? So once you have this global deployment, you will have these opportunities to learn all this from different countries. And the globalization also will speed up the spread of technology, of advanced knowledge. Okay? Because we can use like internet to share or to transfer knowledge, transfer information, or people can get to the internet to search for some knowledge. Right? Or search for some new technology on the internet. Okay. So this will stimulate the advancement of the technology, because people get to know the most advanced knowledge, they have the idea. So how can this technology be further improved? Right? Because they can get access to this, they have the idea how to improve this. So that's why globalization will help the speed of technological change. And also the product commoditization, okay? That means we can get a product quickly to the marketplace, right? Because we do the global deployment. We have a production basis near the market. Okay? Once we have new products or improved products, we can right away make them available in the different parts in the world. So all these are the trends, okay, in the manufacturing sector because of the globalization. Okay, now let's talk about the failures in outsourcing. Why some outsourcing arrangements fail? And according to the statistics, 4 out of 5 business process outsourcing contracts signed today will be negotiated within 2 years, and 20% of them will eventually collapse. Okay, so these are very high percentages that outsourcing arrangements failed in the end. Okay. And also another statistic, 50% outsourcing relationships turn out to be failed within 5 years. That means cannot survive longer than 5 years. Okay. So these two statistics numbers showed us that this is a very severe phenomenon. So many failures for the outsourcing arrangements. Okay. So in order to avoid failure, in the beginning, you need to very careful identify and evaluate proper outsourcees. Right? You have to use very complete criteria to carefully evaluate these potential firms. And then you will still need to make some adjustments in your company in order to align with the outsourcee. Of course, they also need to make some adjustments. I mean, two parties both need to make some adjustments so that their corporate culture will become much similar. Otherwise, if two companies with totally different cultures, eventually they will not, it's very difficult for them to have mutual trust, difficult for them to have commitment to this relationship, okay, unless they get to know each other very well. So we need to evaluate these outsourcees carefully, okay, and we need to have a good strategy to develop a relationship between our outsourcee and our companies. Okay. The different kind of problems, why that the outsourcing arrangements turn out to be a failure. The most popular problems are difference in culture, as I mentioned, right? They don't get to know each other. Difference in culture and customer complaints. That means our customer complain, maybe complain about quality because our outsourcee did not do very good job, then we don't have very reliable products to provide our customers. And customers, they encounter some problems when they use the products. They of course, they will have complaints, right? They will have complaints. Then you will say, okay, my customers have these complaints because you didn't do very good job. So I don't trust you anymore. Maybe I try to monitor your process. I go to your place to see your production process because I don't trust you. And the other party also feel that, okay, you don't trust me. You want to check my steps in my production step, my production process. Okay, gradually, they don't mutually trust. Okay, and this relationship become more and more vulnerable. Any event could make this relationship totally broken. Okay. So custom complaints also will result in the termination of the relationship. Okay. And also other problems like a need for frequent reminders. You always need to remind the outsourcee. You need to pay attention to what part, which parts, etc. For example, remind them to deliver the products on time. Okay. Or you need to care to very pay attention to the quality, to the specification, etc. Okay. And gradually, I think they will lose their patience, the outsourcer. Okay. And they will terminate these relationships, try to look for better firms to have another outsourcing arrangements. And of course, mistakes. The outsourcees make mistakes, and these serious mistakes, of course, will result in some great loss. They encounter some problems for the outsourcers. Okay. And of course, late delivery is also a very severe problem, especially when the outsourcees are in different countries. Usually we rely on marine transportation, right? So marine transportation may be not so reliable, okay? And if that delivery is very frequent situations, then of course this outsourcer will consider maybe just terminate this relationship, try to find other more reliable firms to do the outsourcing. These are most frequently reported reasons why outsourcers wants to terminate the relationships with their outsourcees. Okay. Of course, there are other minor problems like time difference. For example, now we are in the daytime in the United States. They are in the maybe early morning. And communication, right? And because they use different languages, communication also will create problems. Reliability and responsiveness, commitment, cost, realization, competence. So in the beginning, they give you a quoted price, say 100, but they didn't very carefully do the calculation. They give you, okay, we set the price at 100 per unit. Later on, they say, okay, this is not enough for us because I forgot some cost components in the beginning. So I need to increase the cost from 100 to 120. So you'll say, why should I agree with you, right? In the beginning, you promise you can give me, say, 100. Now you ask for 120 or even higher, right? So the company may feel this is not a very reliable, honest firms. Right? So later on, maybe this relationship will not be well developed. Also, outsourcing being polite. Maybe you wonder why being polite is also a problem. You know, in some countries, especially in Oriental company and country, say in Taiwan or maybe in mainland China, people tend to say okay. Tends not to say no. you say we want this, we want that. They just say okay, but finally, they cannot make every promise to be really realized. Right? Then you say, okay, you promised me, you already have this, those are promise, but why you just say to me, no, I cannot do it, I cannot make it? Because originally they are too polite. That's why. Okay. And that's also could be a problem. Okay. But I think that's a cultural factor, cultural problem. Okay. Once you get to know, okay, they have this kind of tendency, then you can be very careful. Okay, make sure whether or not they can really make it according to their capabilities or their resources. You can double check, you can make sure. You can ask them to make promise according to their real capability, not just say yes to everything. And others, confidentiality. I mean, some business secrets, or maybe some secrets about technology, about production, about components. Of course, you don't like these outsourcers to give out this information, right? But maybe they just let this knowledge to be known by other people, especially they give this knowledge, this information to your competitors, and that will hurt your firms very severe. So this is also a reason that they report why they want to terminate the relationship with outsourcers. Okay. So these are either major factors and minor factors that people report it. Why they're, yes.
The thing you said, like being polite.
Mm-hmm. Being polite.
It's pretty active, you know, things. Like that, does it really happen?
Yes.
In Taiwan, quite often.
I don't know how often, but it really happens in these countries, because this is a survey.
Yeah. This comes from the lack of like assessment to the outsourcing, right?
Yes.
Yeah. But like even after the evaluation or the assessment to the outsourcing, like it could happen as well. Like they can still, like I don't mean like they deceive the company, but like they have too much confidence and they just say like, they can
say
yes,
uh-huh.
Like, you know.
Yeah. You mean they are overconfident.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's also possible. Yeah, maybe for some people, they are overconfident, that they cannot, their capability may not be able to help them realize what they promised. Mm-hmm.
This problem is only like minor corporations.
Minor, yeah. Basically, I think most firms, they would evaluate what their own capabilities. Because once they promised their customers things that they eventually they cannot make it, then these firms will also suffer from maybe losing their reputation. Other firms, okay, you always say you can do that, but turn out to be not the case, then yeah, and so other companies may not be interested in doing business with these companies. Yeah, that could happen, but I think maybe these companies didn't have much experiences with foreigners, so they just based on their thinking to do every promise. They say yes, just says yes.
Yeah. Well, I just wonder, because like if there is a new company, it's kind of hard to evaluate the new company. It's like there's no history of background, right?
Mm-hmm.
So like it's kind of hard to make.
Yes. Yeah. That's also a problem. Once you decide to come to this country and in your first time, you don't have any experiences with this. The people in this country or this region, then that will also have some risk. But of course, we can try to contact local people who can help, maybe some consulting firms there, or some associations or chambers, see if they can provide some kind of help to help us to get to know their ways of doing business or their tendencies. They are very polite, but oh no, they are very polite. They might be promise things that they cannot really do it. And we have this idea, so we will try to avoid these things to happen. So then we can reduce this kind of risks. Now, how to select and evaluate outsourcees, okay, the possible firms to transfer our process to them. Okay. And as I mentioned, basically we need to have criteria, right? We have to, we should have a complete set of criteria, okay? And we also need to classify this set of criteria into two parts. One is basic requirement, right? We call them order qualifiers. These are criteria that a potential outsourcee need to meet in order to be considered further as a possible supplier. Okay? For example, maybe we set a criteria, the firm, they need to get certificated by the ISO organization under the ISO 9000 series. Right? This is a quality standard series. Okay. Usually many firms in Taiwan, they got ISO 9000 certification since maybe mid-1990s. Nowadays, this becomes very basic, very popular practices. Right? Almost firms want to do business with foreign firms from Europe or from United States. They plan to get this certificate. So this is one example. Of course, we can still have other qualifiers. Right? You can set different other qualifiers, right? Not just in terms of the quality. So order qualifiers, and of course, another more advanced set or part of criteria are order winners. That means you still need to satisfy even higher standard. Those criteria we called order winners. So two parts. Order qualifiers and order winners. Okay. These are some examples of the order qualifiers. The second one is the example I just mentioned called quality certifications. Others like reliability of delivery on time. Maybe you can set a criteria. I'll say 95%. Okay. According to the historical record of this potential firm. Okay. They need to provide evidence that their performance in terms of the reliability of delivery on time is higher than 95%. Otherwise, they cannot get this order, or they cannot be selected. Okay. Others, like conforms to agreed specifications, or delivery lead time. Okay. Lead time means the time between we place an order and we actually receive the order, the time between these two points. Sometimes we need delivery lead time to be short, not too long. And also, we require lead time to be very reliable. That means we require lead time, say, maybe 3 days. Okay, not the average lead time 3 days. We need precisely. Every time I place an order, I just wait for 3 days. We hope this variation in the lead time to be very, very small. Right? You don't like to see. Sometimes you wait 1 day, 2 days, 3 days. Sometimes you need to wait more than 10 days. That's very not very reliable. That's very, the variation very, very large. So delivery lead time. Financial capability, okay, they have a very sound financial system. They have enough operating capital. Okay? They have very good credit. When they need to get loans from bank, they can right away get the financial support from the banks. Okay? So financial capabilities are important. Okay? Performance track record, okay? Their previous performance. Price, cost reduction. Can they give us a reasonable quoted price? Senior management attitude. Okay. Sometimes, although this is more qualitative, but still, sometimes we need to know how their senior management look at this outsourcing arrangement. Whether or not this senior manager give very great importance on to this arrangement, or this person just consider this is not a very important thing. So we need to know this person's attitude, because we consider this arrangement very serious. This is very important to us. But we also hope their top management can also consider or value this arrangement. Consider this is an important decision. This is a very important commitment for both sides. Right? So the attitude is important. And their flexibility or responsibility to demand uncertainty. Sometimes we cannot anticipate our demand from our customers. We cannot anticipate our demand very accurately. Right? Sometimes our customers give us an order, emergent orders. Right? They say, because of some reason, we need to have an emergent order of how many units. And we need to give this to our outsourcees to ask them to fulfill this order for us. Then if this outsourcee can use any strategy to satisfy this emergent orders, then this is a good one for us. Right? Otherwise, then we cannot satisfy our customers. So this is not good. So sometimes we need to look at whether or not they can have this kind of flexibility. Right? In order to have this kind of flexibility, of course, they can do some arrangement. Right? They can have some companies to help them to complete this order. If they cannot have enough capacity, right? They have very good relationship with their other maybe sometimes competitors, their firms. Once they cannot finish this order by themselves, they can just give part of the order to their competitors. We need to also evaluate whether or not they have this kind of ability. Okay. So this is responsiveness to demand uncertainty. Okay. And the last one is, last example is a record of their CSR. That means their corporate social responsibility. This is a more ethical part. Okay. If an outsourcee does not have a very good reputation in terms of like their labor or their working environment conditions, etc., they hire kids. Okay. Usually we don't hire kids, right? Usually we hire adults, more than maybe 18 years old, depends on the country. And we usually don't hire kids. However, some undeveloped countries, their kids, because they want to make money, earn money to support their family, they go to the factory to work for the factory. But this is not good in terms of the ethical perspective. Because we don't like our children to work when they, at their age, they really need to receive educations. Right? Some people don't consider this is a good practice to hire kids. Right? And also, some also sees they don't pay attention, or they maybe use some materials or some components that maybe not good to our health. Right? And this would maybe cause users to get sick, to have some problems in their bodies. So this is not ethical, right? So once the firm has this kind of records, usually we don't consider them as a supplier. Otherwise, you will also suffer from once the products have some problem, then you will also lose your reputation. So this is not good. So we try to avoid this. So we need to inspect their records to see whether or not they have some bad records in this perspective. If they have this kind of records, then even we don't consider them as a possible suppliers. And these are examples of other qualifiers. So this is a flow chart to summarize that the process I just mentioned. In the beginning, we need to make a decision whether or not to do the outsourcing. Okay, if we make our decision, yes, I want to do the outsourcing, then we need to evaluate the potential outsourcees, right? According to other qualifiers on the first stage, whether or not they satisfy. This particular one satisfies the older qualifier. Okay, if yes, then go ahead. See if they satisfy older winners, those advanced criteria. Okay, if yes, okay, we decide to have business with them. We decide to outsource our process to this firm. But we ask one question again. Is this the first time that we have cooperation with this firm? If yes, then we need to consider the difference between two companies, especially the working environment differences. And we need to evaluate the differences. We have these differences in mind. We can use some kind of quantitative tools to evaluate this. We can come up with a figure. And basically, we can use some kind of index, right, to evaluate this cultural differences. And we have the figures, and we know we are quite different from our outsourcees, and we let them know that we are not so different. Both sides, both parties need to make some adjustment. We need to let this firm know how we do things, and we also need to know how they do things, how they look at things, etc. And then we try to make adjustments and hope later on we can get more similar in terms of the company's cultures. And then we need to consider how to manage this relationship. Okay. So we can maybe look at relationships and determine what form of relationship we want to develop. Okay. Later on we have four stages about the relationships. Okay. Then you need to decide what relationship you want to begin with. Okay. So it's a master slave stage or others. Okay. Later on we have a slide for that four different stages. Okay. Also, sometimes we need to consider whether or not we need to have some contingency plan. Okay. For example, maybe you are not so sure about their delivery reliability in the beginning. Maybe you ask this outsourcee to keep higher inventory in your site. This outsourcee maybe in another country, and you ask them to maintain higher inventory in your country. Right? Of course, this will increase their costs. Right? But this is just in order to avoid some kind of risks. For example, they cannot deliver their goods on time. Then still, they here in your country, they maintain certain level of inventory that can be used. Otherwise, you have to wait. Then this maybe also will not satisfy your customer in time. And then we have to consider the cost of managing the relationship. Do we need to invest more than we benefit from the relationship? So we do a cost-benefit analysis, right? If we can benefit more than we spend in terms of money, in terms of our time, then this is a deal we can go ahead and we implement this outsourcing arrangement. So from the beginning to the final step, we consider criteria, different criteria, and also finally we consider cost and benefit. We know now this is a worthy relationship to develop, to pursue. Okay. So this is a flow chart, help us to make the outsourcing arrangement step by step, carefully. Okay. The final part of this chapter is about the relationship stage. The relationship between outsourcer and outsourcee actually can evolve from the beginning very equivalent situation to later on peer-to-peer, more equivalent positions. So typically four stages. In the beginning, the first stage, I think the outsourcee doesn't have experiences with this firm, and because they have good performance record, so they get this business. They become the outsourcee. Okay, but they still are not very capable compared with the outsourcers. So in this stage, we call master servant stage. On this stage, the outsourcer sets expectations, sets rules, and then the outsourcee just follow the rules. Just try to follow the rules. Also, on this stage, the cost, especially low cost, is the main concern. That means because the outsourcee can promise quite low cost, although they maybe cannot guarantee quality, right? But at least they are cheaper. Okay. So why call this master-servant stage? Because they don't know how to make product in terms of make a very good quality products. They need to learn from the outsourcers. Right? So in this stage, the master teach the outsourcee about quality control, quality design, etc. And then this firm gradually learn how to make good quality goods, how to arrange delivery properly so that the delivery can be on time. Okay, so they are at the learning stage for the servant or for the outsourcee. Then the second stage is consultative stage. The second stage, the outsourcer gradually doesn't monitor the operations of the outsourcee so often. In the beginning stage, maybe the outsourcer need to check very frequently, even day to day, every day, monitor or check their operations, whether there are problems or some operations need to be adjusted or need to be improved. Okay. But on this consolidated stage, because the outsourcee learn how to do these practices in the first stage, so they gradually, the outsourcer can reduce their frequency to monitor this firm. Okay. And on this stage, of course, the outsourcees can provide not just a lower cost, but also they can have flexibility, they can be flexible, right, to help the outsourcers to deal with the emergent orders, for example, right? Cost, quality, reliability, responsiveness, or flexibility. These four factors actually are very, very important for every outsourcers. not the cost. Maybe in the beginning, they say, okay, I go to a country. I mean, I outsource my process to this country, the firm in this country, because they're lower labor cost. But gradually, this is not the eventual or the final goal. They want a also see have very good performance on these four perspectives. Otherwise, this is not a successful outsourcing, right? Because the quality or durability or the flexibility cannot be guaranteed. Okay. So the consolidative stage we can have as a outsourcer, we can have lower cost, higher quality, good reliability, and fast responsiveness. So this is the second stage. The third stage, now, peer-to-peer relation stage. Gradually, the firms, the outsourcees, they become more and more familiar, become more and more skilled in terms of doing this process, this, say, maybe a production process. So now they can actively make recommendations, make suggestions to the outsourcers. If we can make some improvements on this production, then we can have good, even better performance, right? Then at this stage, it becomes a peer-to-peer, right? Peer-to-peer. Both sides become more equivalent in terms of the positions, so it's peer-to-peer. And then finally, it could happen to the last stage, so-called competitive stage. The outsourcees say, okay, I want to establish a plan to compete with the outsourcer. For example, the OEM companies in Taiwan, originally, maybe they assemble computers for their outsourcers. But gradually, after several years, they have the ability to produce very reliable, very good quality computers. They can develop their own brand. And they establish their own brand, then that means they say, I want to compete with my outsourcers in the final markets. I just not satisfied just doing the OEM for you. I want to go to the consumer markets to compete with you. Okay, that's the competitive stage, okay, the final stage. Of course, when this stage come to the two parts, then maybe they will eventually terminate their relationship, or they will reduce their cooperation. Maybe they reduce the business, right? And the outsourcers maybe say, I try to look for, search for some other possible firms to do outsourcing arrangements. Okay. So that could happen. Okay, this is the final part of this chapter.